Our first speaker this morning is Alex Wright, who will talk about nearly Fuchsian surface subgroups of finite covolume finite groups.
Okay, thanks for the introduction and the invitation to speak here today. So I hope you don't feel too betrayed. I'm going to try talking about today something other than translation surfaces and tegular dynamics. But I promise next time I'll get back to the tegular dynamics. So today I'm going to talk about joint work with Jeremy Kahn, where we show the following theorem that I'll explain. So it concerns finite volume cusp hyperbolic tree manifolds. So such a thing looks like hyperbolic tree space modulo a discrete subgroup of isometries. And we'll show that these contain so-called quasi-Fuchsian subgroups. Okay, so I want to explain what that means. So intuitively, what we consider, in general in math, when you have a complicated object, and certainly hyperbolic three manifolds are complicated rich objects, you can try to understand them by probing them with simpler objects. So thinking about maps from simpler objects into the complicated objects. So here that manifests in thinking about maps from surfaces to three manifolds. So you'd like to take a hyperbolic surface, and really ideally you'd like to find sort of isometric maps in, or at least maps that are local isometries. Now this, it turns out, is too much to ask for. Typically there won't be any sort of totally geodesic surfaces sitting inside of a hyperbolic tree manifold. But you could ask to get something fairly close. So these are going to be closed surfaces, by the way. So we'd like to think about maps like this that are almost isometric. And the idea, so that's a little bit hard to make precise, since the three manifold has contractible universal cover, it's always enough to think about the fundamental group. So instead of thinking about the surface, you can think about the fundamental group of the surface. And there it's easier to make a precise definition. And that's that, so let's call this map F. So you look at the image of the fundamental group, and this gives you a subgroup inside of gamma, and you call that K quasi-Fuchsian. There's some definition of K quasi-Fuchsian, which I'd essentially rather not define. I would rather you think that a subgroup is K quasi-Fuchsian if it comes from some sort of almost isometric inversion. If you really insist that I define the terms in the talk, then something K quasi-Fuchsian is something whose action on the boundary sphere is conjugate via K quasi-conformal map to the action of a Fuchsian group. But if you hadn't heard that before, I'd actually rather you just forget it, because it's sort of quite technical. And really, I want you to think that the goal is to find maps from a closed hyperbolic surface into the three manifold that's almost isometric. Okay, and I also haven't defined ubiquitous, but let's just say it means lots. Okay, so really I want to show that there are lots of maps that are as close to isometrically immersed as you want from a hyperbolic surface into the three manifold.
Does it mean separates points?
Yeah, it means the circles at infinity separates points.
Okay. Yeah.
Any other questions about the statements? That's it. That's the one thing I want to talk to you about today. So let me tell you a little bit about the context. So first of all, a big case of this is already known. Through the celebrated work of Kahn and Markovich that appeared in print in 2012, and they showed the case when M is closed. So it's compact, it has no cusps. The contribution of this new theorem is that it allows the hyperbolic three manifold to have cusps. If there weren't cusps, it was already known. And actually, this theorem wasn't even known for a single cusp hyperbolic three manifold before this work, unless it actually was one of these very rare and special examples that had geodesic surfaces. So as I said, this is a celebrated result. One of the reasons is that it was an ingredient in Engel's resolution of the Virchow-Hawking conjecture. So somehow understanding these surfaces inside of the three-manifold helps very much to understand the three-manifold. So a little bit more context. There's some work of Masters and Zhang from 2008. They show that there exists a K quasi-Fuchsian subgroup for some inside of any cusp hyperbolic tree. So it was already known there was at least one for some K. Oh, and I left out something important here. So K close to 1. So the closer K is to 1, the closer this is to being almost isometric. Okay. So theirs isn't really necessarily almost isometric, but they can find one that's sort of a little bit isometric.
So that's for the cusp case.
That's for the cusp
case.
Not
for the closed case.
I think it's also for the closed case. I don't know if it's for the closed case. I'd have to check. It might just be for the cusp case. I don't know. And then Cooper and Fuder upgraded that to a ubiquitous collection. Again, for some K. So Masters and Zhang found one for some K, and Cooper and Fuder, an independent work that was sort of roughly simultaneous to ours, although they did a much better job of writing it up quickly. So maybe they should get credit for doing it first just because they wrote it up already and ours is still to appear. So they showed there exists some K greater than 1, so that there are lots of these surface groups. It's actually important to have lots for a few reasons, for these applications to understanding the structure of the three-manifold or its fundamental group. So, for example, this was already realized that this would be important. This answers a question of Engel, as our sort of simultaneous work. And likely the reason he was interested is because you can use this to recover a theorem of Danny Wise that says that gamma acts freely and co-compactly on a cat zero cube complex. And Groves and Manning also used this to get a new proof of another theorem of Wise that gamma is virtually special. Which again would have been known via work of Engel, I think, in the co-compact case. And part of our other motivation
is... So for virtual Hawking, do you need that K can be as close to 1 as you want, or...?
No, you don't. So this was independent and sort of roughly simultaneous work to ours. The difference in the statement is that we get close to Fuchsian, and they only get sort of Fuchsian, but this is actually enough for the applications they had in mind. I'll comment on part of our motivation. So there's a now getting fairly old question about is there a convex co-compact subgroup of the mapping class group?
Closed surface subgroup.
I'll just say surface subgroup. I'll always mean closed when I say surface subgroup. Surface. A little jet lagged here. Surface. And the one idea for approaching this is you'd sort of like to take your hyperbolic three-manifold and instead of using that, try to think about the moduli space agreement services. Find some reasonable surface inside of the moduli space agreement services. Now, this is a very hard problem. MG is difficult to work with for a number of reasons. Maybe the simplest reason is that it's not co-compact. So part of our motivation personally in thinking about this is we wanted to start to develop techniques that would work in a non-co-compact setting. And that's another difference between our work and the work of Cooper and Fuder, is they somehow managed to reduce to the closed case, where we extend the techniques to apply in the non-closed case. So that's the statement and a bit of context. Any questions? Yes?
Do you know that it's not sharp, that there are quasi, like you don't need to, that you don't have, you have examples of finite volume through manifolds where?
Yeah, I think certainly there are certainly lots of examples with no actual Fuchsian surface set group.
Oh, okay.
And I think it's an open question, let's see if I can get this right, that if there are sufficiently many totally geodesic surfaces, then it should be arithmetic. So it sort of would be a rare thing to have a lot of totally geodesic things. You would expect to have some underlying special structural reason for that. That wouldn't be the MG. Okay. Other questions? Okay, so expositionally, the correct thing for me to do now is not to jump in to my work with Jeremy. It's to first tell you about Jeremy's work with Vlad Markovic, about the closed case, because we're really building on their techniques. So I want to sort of talk to you about the case if M is closed. And certainly we'll be generalizing those techniques. So the idea is you want to build a surface out of pants. Find a bunch of pants inside of the three manifold and then glue them together to form a surface. To ensure that we have lots of pants, what we'll do is we'll make all three cuff lengths huge. So for some number, it's usually called 2R, that's enormous. Okay, so I should say a little bit, sort of surprisingly, I don't think to this day we know a really explicit way of building a surface set. So this is sort of a probabilistic or random construction. The idea is to come up with some enormous random collection of pants and to sort of glue them together in some reasonable way and then get some giant surface out of it that sort of winds all around the three manifold. It's not like we're going to build one reasonable one. We're going to build tons of really huge ones that sort of almost wind around densely. So the fact that the cuff lengths are large means this is a very misleading picture. Okay, because this here all the cuff lengths look about one. So if the cuff lengths are very large, really what this looks like is almost like you start with two ideal hyperbolic triangles. And then you sort of join them with these thin filament things inside the hyperbolic three manifolds. And of course, these are really sort of two-dimensional, but they're very thin. And then what you get is you have three boundary curves. So it's a sphere with three holes. So you could actually try to build them, and originally we did try to build them by starting with these two triangular bits and joining them with these geodesics. There's a different approach that we use, so we can build these pants starting with one closed geodesic of length 2R, so R is this enormous number. Okay, so there are lots of closed geodesics, as you know, is shown in Margulis' thesis, and other places, the number of geodesics of length L grows exponentially in L. So you start with the geodesic of length 2R, that really, because R is enormous, it looks like it's winding around the manifold a lot. And then you find what's called an orthogeodesic connection. So you pick two opposite points on your closed geodesic, and then you find a perpendicular. So you can't find one from any point to any other point, but you could find one from, you know, a little ball here to a little ball here. And again, those sort of be exponentially many. There are lots of them. And then what you do is you sort of take this, and you from this you get three geodesics. One is your geodesic here, another is a geodesic like this. And another is a geodesic like this. And you get a pants. Again, they're very, very thin pants. That's just what they look like.
There's some issue about twisting, but you just...
So that's exactly right. So if we're trying to build something that's sort of almost like a hyperbolic surface, then actually this should be almost, you know, almost sitting inside a hyperbolic plane or something like that. There's an interesting invariant in three manifolds. Even if you have a closed geodesic, what you could do is you can take a perpendicular tangent, like a normal tangent vector, and you can parallel translate it around, and it can come back with some angle. And if it comes back with a big angle, then that's really very different than sort of lying inside of an isometric copy of hyperbolic two space. So already, you don't want to use all geodesics. You want to use just the so-called good ones, the ones so that when you parallel translate a normal around, you get back to about itself. And really what you want is you want to be able to take this normal vector and parallel translate it around and get something very close to that normal vector. Okay, and if you do that, that will be called good. So pants will be good if when you take this normal vector and parallel translate it around, you almost get this normal.
That follow from some topology that exists?
Oh, yeah, so exponential mixing means you have lots of these. Wise bots of great pants, and they're equidistributed about each cusp. So again, each of these three boundary circles I'm calling a cuff. And you look at a segment of a cuff. This is maybe like this segment or something here. And you can find orthogeodesics shooting out in just about any direction. So I can sort of plot the tangent vectors of all of these sort of orthogeodesic connections, and this would be fairly well equidistributed, fairly well spread out in the unit normal bundle to the curve. And there aren't sort of more in one area of the unit normal bundle than another area. This is, since it's exponential mixing, you really have very fine control on this. Okay. So now we have tons and tons and tons of pants, like exponentially many inside of my closed three manifold. They're long and thin, and I want to glue together the collection of all of these so-called good pants to get a surface. But of course, I have to glue it together in some nice way if I want to get something geometrically coherent. So I want to assemble to get a nice So again, assemble means that at each cuff you're going to glue together two pants. Okay, so the pants are going to be paired with each other around each cuff. So I want to compare this to something easy in H2 to talk about what it would mean to get something nice. So nice, of course, should mean almost asymmetric. So an analogy is maybe in H2 I have a bunch of sort of unit length segments and I want to glue them together to get something that's almost a geodesic. Okay, so I start, I have some unit length segment, and then here I have, I'll glue it to another unit length segment and another and another and another and another and another and another. And if you glue them so the unit length segments have sort of bounded bending between them, then this will stay close to a geodesic. But you just have to not bend too much. Okay, now this would get a little bit more difficult if my segments were not unit length, but like epsilon or something. For a given amount of bending, if I make the segments too small, then I can't glue the segments together and have it track a geodesic. Because if it's too small, I like take a tiny step, bend, take a tiny step, bend. Eventually I'll sort of curl back on myself. I just won't get anything nice. So this is actually a big potential issue here. Because again, I want to think about this pants. So I want to think about this. So in here, this gets very thin. These like two geodesics in hyperbolic space that stay distant, say almost one from each other for a long segment, actually get exponentially close. So sort of a segment of a pants might be, okay, so here's my triangular part, and then I have these two geodesics, and then I get back to this other triangular part, and in between, the thickness is e to the minus r, the distance between those two geodesics. And if I tried to glue together a bunch of segments of length e to the minus r, then even with very small bending angle, I could sort of turn back on itself. And I don't want that to happen. I want to assemble these pants into something that looks like essentially a two-dimensional geodesic, a hyperbolic plane. And so at first it looks like this might sink the ship, in that it turns out you can't get enough control on bending if you're going to have segments this big. But there's a fairly pleasing trick to get around it. And that's that you glue together the pants with a so-called offset of one, or a translation of one. So that means, so here's my geodesic, and my orthogeodesic went over here. So you might think I should glue it together so the next orthogeodesic goes over here. But in fact, you don't want to do that. You want to translate by one. So this segment has length one, and then you have some new pants that sort of looks like this. And then again, so here's my orthogeodesic, so I'll translate by one, and I'll put in a new pants. Like this. And then again. And now you can think about, you know, what it's like to be an ant on the surface that you built, and you can think about sort of making a journey where you're crossing all of these geodesics. And as you make that journey, sometimes you're making very thin steps before you hit the next place where you bend. But sometimes you're going to cross through this sort of triangular region, or the thick part of the pants. And that's like making a big step. And this actually allows you to have the control you need. Okay, so it's like you're assembling something out of segments in H2, and some of your steps are very small, but say every rth step is size 1. And as long as you have some size 1 steps in there, you don't need nearly as much control on the bending. So you can allow sort of bigger bending and you can still track a geodesic. And so this is what Kahn and Markovich do. They glue together all the pants with an offset by 1. And then they show that they get something almost isometric. So I'll write that as a theorem. This is Kahn and Markovich. Very good assembly. Good pants. place in it. So again, a good pants is one where you have some nice control. You parallel translate this red guy, you get almost the other one. And a good assembly is one where you have very small bending between the pants and an offset of one every time you glue them together between the sort of thick triangular pieces. So all I want to say about the proof is that it's actually quite hard. And I mainly want to say that because I sort of made it look easy, right? Because this fact in hyperbolic two space is quite easy. Yeah, this is an exercise. But it turns out getting sort of a very good two-dimensional version, maybe they prove a bit better of a version than they need. But certainly proving the version that they get is actually quite challenging. And I think that often surprises people, given that the geometric intuition is so clear and transparent. But I just want to warn you that actually technically it's quite challenging to prove it, like, the optimal version of that. So I want to sort of just recap this discussion. So to prove this, so outline that M is closed, sort of already given it, but you take all of your tans, at each cuff, you match them with small bend and offset by one. And done, since the pants are equidistributed at each cuff. And then when you do this, once you have this good assembly of good pants, then it's almost isometric. Okay, so I just want to compare this So, at each cuff, really you're thinking about these red vectors here that tell you which direction to go to get the orthogeny. And you're using that set is equidistributed. A simpler thing would just be to sort of take a cross section and now you have a circle. And I want to sort of think about a Torrey problem there. So any equidistributed subset of S1 of even size can be paired into almost opposite pairs. So you're adding a circle, and you have some set of points on the circle size, and you could sort of make them, add an extra point or two here. You can pair them so that each guy is almost on the opposite side of the circle of its pair. Okay, and this you prove using the Hall marriage theorem. And by the way, how do you get even size? You can always just take two copies of each point. Then you sort of just get rid of that for free.
Can you fill that last comment again? What do you mean by taking two copies?
You might say, like, well, how do you know you have an even number of points? Like, what if I count the number of pants with a given cuff and I find I have an odd number? Like, aren't you screwed? You can't pair them. But actually, you take two copies of each pants. If you're going to be picky, you take one copy of each pants with each trace of orientation. And when you do this, then you sort of lose this pairing instruction. The simpler version is if you had a set, I could just take, on the circle, I could take each point with multiplicity 2. And then I could pair it. So this is sort of more of an exercise that you could try to do. This is sort of fun.
What's the almost?
You can distribute it. You can quantify all of this. Really, the Hall marriage theorem sort of says you have two subsets, and on each side, you know, every subset of people, every subset of men, you look at all the women they'd be happy to be paired with, and there has to be a bigger subset of women. So really what you do is you take some set of points here that's like very small, and then you look at maybe a bigger set here, and you want to know there are more points over here than here. Say this is delta, and this is 2 delta maybe. Then you know, this is sort of the, then you know that every point can be paired to one of the delta that's opposite. So you need something like that. Yeah, so you can quantify all of it. Okay, this Hall marriage theorem is just something purely combinatorial, but you apply it to, you know, the set of points with some relation, you know, being opposite to within some delta or something.
So how many pans did the surfaces you end up constructing actually have?
All of them. Which is like e to the 3r or something.
Surface is not necessarily connected.
It's not necessarily connected, but it's, you know, as far as we know, it's connected.
And maybe it has a big component.
It so probably at least has a big component. Put together, think randomly. So you have all of these pants that are going crazy. You have like, I think it's like e to the 3r of them. And then you sort of glue them together and you get this enormous surface. It may or may not be connected. But if you look at a connected component, then that theorem will say that it's almost asymmetrically immersed. And again, really, there's this caveat. You're always actually thinking about the fundamental group of the surface rather than the surface itself. So really, you're building a surface subgroup.
Okay. It's clear that the theorem can't be true of the form of the genus of the subsets?
That I don't know.
So what was the
Maybe
question?
Other people know. The question was, might the theorem be true with some sort of control on the genus of the subsurface? And so there are probably people in the room who know something about that, but I don't. Okay, so if there are no more questions, I now want to talk about the new part. Okay, so that was in the closed case. So now, what's new when M has cusps? So first of all, I'll remind you, these cusps are sort of like the cusps of a hyperbolic surface, except they have torus cross-sections. So really what you can think of is upper half space, and then, you know, each, you have these four balls, and maybe you mod out by two translations, like z goes to z plus 1 and z goes to z plus I. Then that will get you a model for this cusp, where you'll see this cross-section will be this four ball, this plane sort of parallel to infinity, modulo that group stabilizing cusp. So here it's really easy to say the basic problem. And that's that any geodesic of length 2r goes at most r into the cusp. So like is the case for cusp hyperbolic surfaces, you can't have a geodesic living in the cusp. Right? Then you would be, you could just slide it off to infinity. So a geodesic sort of has to go to the compact set. So you know, really it has to do something in the compact set, and then it can conceivably travel outwards and then sort of wrap around and come back. But it certainly can't go, there's some maximum distance it can go out the cusp. And that's actually enough to sort of screw you. Just draw you a little picture. Okay, so I'm always going to draw the cusp up. So what you might have is you might have a pants. It looks something like this, where this is height R. So height R means distance R from a fixed compact subset. So I might have a pants that looks like this, and this is sort of vertical facing. Okay, so what does this need to be paired for with? Well, I sort of have this orthogeodesic pointing straight down. So the next one should go up like that. So if I were to pair with something, I have to pair with something that, let me do this in another color, because the point is you can't do this. But it would have to look something like that. And it would just go too high. So it's just, it's not true anymore that you have equal distribution. Okay. So pants, not equal distribution. If you use just the collection of all good pants. Okay, so at first that seems sort of damning. Without accurate distribution, you can't glue things together so that, you know, things are almost opposite. And here is really bad, because if you glued it to anything, it would sort of have to point down again. So you have to glue it with a quite extreme bending angle. So the collection of pants about each cup is not equally distributed, so they can't be assembled into a good assembly. Okay, but this is a fairly extreme example. John, do you have a question?
What do you want it to be equidistributed?
Oh, so let me rewrite that. So the pants are not equidistributed about each cuff. So it's the same thing I had here, about each cuff. I could plot.
In terms of angle?
So I get a subset of the normal bundle to the cuff of all the directions that I can go in to find this orthogeodesic. And that gives me a subset of this normal bundle, so I'm not equidistributing that normal bundle.
Oh, and the ones that are going into the cusp are the less
likely. Essentially, because you can't point up into the cusp too much, or you'll be forced to go too high. So you're not equidistributed in the normal bundle, because the vectors that point straight out into the cusp are no good. They would go too high.
So cusps repel.
Cusps sort of repel geodesics of a given fixed length.
Cusps repel cuffs.
Yeah, cusps repel closed geodesics even, yeah. Which is the perfect segue. Most geodesics of length 2R don't go nearly so far out into the cusp. This is insanely atypical behavior. So you might as well say get rid of it. So really, most of them don't go more than a multiple of log R into the cusp. Okay, so the geodesics actually don't go anywhere near the side. So this is a very sort of misleading picture. So really, you say, consider only pants below a cutoff height. So consider only pants below a cutoff height, h sub cutoff, which is a constant times log r. Not the same constant. So this, in a sense, fixes the problem, because if you look at only the cuffs very low down, you still have very good equidistribution. But there's still this problem. So maybe I'll do this in a color here. So, same problem. Which is that I could just replace this with sort of the cutoff height. And if I have a pants like this that goes all the way up to the cutoff height and is pointing up, you know, there may be plenty of other good pants there, but they're not good pants below the cutoff height. So if you go low enough, then you will have good equidistribution of all good pants around each cup, But then they sort of force you to keep going up and up. So if you just put a cutoff to them, no, I'm not using any pants at all below the above the cutoff height, it's as if they don't exist, you face exactly the same problem, which is that pants that go near the cutoff and point up can't be matched. You still don't have good enough height distribution. Okay, so now is the time for government intervention. You know, Karl Markovich is sort of a free market approach. You just take all the pants, you know, and they just all like, sort of assemble themselves, and you have to prove that it works. And you have to prove the free market works, but then, you know, it's good. Whereas here, it's just somehow not working. You can't, things will not sort of pair themselves. So we need to intervene. So I'll tell you the solution now. And I'll just tell you the whole outline of the solution, and then I'll explain it a little bit. Okay. One. Do your best to assemble. So start, do what you can, you know, match just as well as you can. And then, you know, then you have some unmatched things left. And part of this is actually you can do a fairly good job of assembling, because, you know, really, the only bad guys are the ones that come up very high. But there are still some bad guys. You can come up not so high, but then you'd really have to be pointing very, very vertically. Because if you were even a little bit tilted, then you'd be fine. But anyways, you do your best to assemble, and you sort of do a decent job. In particular, like, in the compact part, like below height 10, you can just match everything. So really, then there's this sort of gradual thing that as you go closer and closer to the cutoff, then there's some bigger portion of things that you can't match around that cusp. Okay, so you do your best to assemble, you have some unmatched guys. So for each, this is the government intervention, for each unmatched cuff, you build something to match to it. Okay, so you're getting your hand through, you're gonna, not out of, out of totally new things, this is you're adding to the free market, sort of adding something new. So build a surface, which we'll call an umbrella. I'll draw you a picture. One of whose boundaries? Is the unmatched cuff. And whose other boundaries are quite low. Are low. So say below a target height. HT. So HT is also a multiple of log R, but you should think that this constant is much less than the constant I had before. So the cutoff height is some huge multiple of log R, and then the target height is some very modest multiple of log R. Okay. So what does this look like? I want to draw you some sort of picture. So, maybe here's your unmatched cuff. Okay, and it's been matched to some, here's sort of a pants that goes over here. And so I think I really sort of made a partial assembly, but it sort of ends here. But really this is sort of more likely to be pointing vertically up a little bit. Quite vertically up, I'm not very good at drawing. So I've assembled some stuff, but then I've gotten stuck at this cuff. There's nothing to match it to. So what I do is I build some surface, one of whose boundaries is there, and whose other boundaries are all below some target height. So in this new surface,
this surface is not transparent.
I'll comment on that in a minute. It's a big, complicated surface. It's certainly not just a single pair of pants. This is what we call the umbrella. And it has new boundaries. That are sort of low, in that they're sort of way further, way closer to the compact part. But they need matching. Okay. Now you say, well, like, you haven't made the problem any better. Actually, you've made it worse. Because here you have one unmatched cuff. And this umbrella I make is actually going to have a ton of unmatched cuffs. You say, haven't you made it worse? But you've transferred the problem, actually. And sort of the economy, so to speak, in the compact part is much more robust. There are way more pants. It's much easier sort of to perturb it and have it be fine. So you've added new unmatched cuffs, but you've moved the problem from far in the cusp, where there's not much to work with, to near the compact part, where things are very robust.
I don't think I understand the umbrella, but what's the bending going to be?
So you're going to try to build it so that it's almost isometric.
But we had the unmatched pants was going straight up.
Yeah, so I'll draw a cross-section in a moment. Okay. But the idea is you want to, so you're going to build this iteratively and sort of bend slowly away from. So this will go, this is not a good picture. I'm sorry, I can't draw good pictures. But this guy will sort of go higher and then come down. So if it was sort of pointing vertically, you have to match it with something almost vertical. But you can do almost vertical and then you're allowed some bend. And then if you build it iteratively, you're allowed some other bend and some other bend. And so you try to look this thing up, sort of look, I'll draw you a picture in a moment.
The boundary lengths are the same length.
Yeah, all of these are length. Because you want this to be compatible with your sort of already robust economy of pants. So I'll just write down the final step of the outline and then I'll actually explain it and answer some of these questions in more depth. So the third and final step that I've already alluded to is rematch below. To incorporate the boundaries of umbrellas. Right. And the key is then that you can't create too many boundaries of umbrellas. So you, below the target height, you forget you had ever matched in anything. So you have this new economy which consists of all of the pants, but also the boundaries of these umbrellas, and you try to rematch them. And the idea is there's just so many pants in this compact part, unlike, you know, far into the cusp where things become more sparse, there's so many pants that maybe the addition of these umbrellas is like a sort of perturbation of what you had before. And so hopefully you can still match. But that's the key, you have to check this.
So for example, it's not important for the new boundaries to be themselves that are distributed.
They have to be so-called semi-random, which is vastly weaker than equidistributed. It would be very bad if you had some sort of conspiracy and there was only one boundary curve for the umbrellas and it occurred with like enormous multiplicity. That would screw up the matching there. So you need to prove the so-called semi-randomness, which says that nothing like that happens. But you don't need nearly anything as strong as equidistribution of the new boundaries. The idea is they'll just be so few that it's sort of a lower order term.
What's the phrase?
Semi-random. Yeah, which says that, so really what you show is that each boundary occurs at most some polynomial times more than it would occur if it was equidistributed. Okay, so what do these look like? So I'm going to draw a picture in the upper half space. I'll do my best. My artistic skills are poor, but I've actually been practicing this. this. That's my attempt to draw a geodesic plane in hyperbolic tree space. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut out a section of it. So that's a geodesic plane missing half plane. So it's like you could actually do, you can like take a geodesic and now you cut something off, and now you're missing half the plane. So this is the cuff that you sort of had to build this umbrella for. And then really what it looks like is you,
so it's a broken umbrella.
All government inventions are broken.
No, it's a broken umbrella. It has like one arch that's much. You've seen these in the stores, right? They have like asymmetric umbrellas that are sort of missing one bit at the front, I guess. Yeah, it's like that. So this is a picture of the universal cover of this, in the universal cover of this umbrella. This is the thing you were trying to match. You built this sort of dome-like thing, which may, if this was some vertical pants, this might have to start going upwards. But the idea is you build it sort of, it gently tilts down. And then this is the umbrellas, and so the idea is this guy might be sort of at the cutoff height, but these guys are way lower, at the much lower target height.
But it's the universal cover, so there's actually a whole collection of them which are at the higher point, right? Every 20.
Yeah, yeah. This is the picture in one horse here.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's all sorts of complicated stuff down here.
And HT doesn't go to infinity with R?
HT is a fixed multiple of log R, so it does go to infinity with R.
So the number
but
of
then H cutoff is a much bigger multiple of log R.
So the number of bound points you get at the bottom would be proportional to the ratio of constants.
Yeah, something like that, yeah. Yeah, actually, like, you know, two times the difference or something. So you need to know the area of a ball in hyperbolic space. Mm-hmm. In hyperbolic two space. And that's sort of... okay, anyways. So how to build... umbrella. So try one, and implicit in try one is that it doesn't work, so then you need to try two. in good pants and tilt gradually away. Like create new bands and you just sort of glue them on one bit at a time and you sort of make this dome out of them, always tilting. The problem is that cuffs can have multiple cuspic versions. So you have this cuff and it sort of goes out into the cusp, but then it might go around the thick part and then go out into the cusp again. And maybe to tilt away from the cusp in each location is just totally different. And you get some clash, you know, tilting away from the cusp here. So you have to sort of parallel translate that direction. And maybe that would be pointing straight at the cusp here. And worse than that, as you create this sort of giant umbrella, how do you know you're not creating new cusp excursions? Maybe you have something in the compact part, but then as you build down from the cusp in one area, you're building into the cusp in another area. Okay, so this sort of doesn't, we weren't able to make that work. But we found a pretty easy solution to it. So solution, so this is try two, build out of hamster wheels. You all know what a hamster wheel is. Let me draw a slightly different picture of a hamster wheel. So here's sort of your duties in costume. This is, you need to glue something onto this. So here's your sort of procedure. This has length 2r. So you draw a new curve of length 2r, but that's in below the target height. So it doesn't look like it, but these have the same length. And then you draw them by a bunch of, you join them by a bunch of spokes. So these are sort of four of the GDC connections. And you do like about every one, or I think for some technical reason you did two, it doesn't matter. About every one. And so these segments are about length r, so that these geodesics are length 2r. So this is some sort of new good component, a generalization of a good pants. Every boundary still has length 2r. But now it looks, it sort of has a different geometry. And what's nice is that this subdivides the cusp excursions. So this outer geodesic might have gone into the cusp several times. But I pick these, I pick this guy and I pick these sort of geodesic connections. So I can make these point down and not make any sort of unnecessary cusp excursions. So these new guys, new boundary, has at most one cusp excursion.
So the spokes aren't random.
The spokes are mostly random, but not entirely random.
You have to
avoid things that are sort of unlikely. Multiple cusp excursions is sort of unlikely beyond a certain height. Keep in mind, even this target height is very high. So like a random geodesic doesn't go above the target height at all, unless it has to. So you sort of constantly subdivide the entries into the cusp this way and make sure you're not creating any new entries into the cusp. Okay. So now let's just conclude with a discussion of what happens in the end. So the idea is you fix the target height and make the cutoff height really, really big. So in other words, this is some fixed multiple of log r, and this is, you're thinking of making this a bigger and bigger and bigger multiple of log r. So what happens when you make the cutoff height bigger? Well, first of all, at low geodesics, equidistribution gets better. Because you're looking at everything below the target height, and you're setting the target height to infinity. So at the very low geodesics, you get better equidistribution and better matching. And on the other hand, few geodesics reach the cutoff height. Because I'm setting the cutoff height to infinity. So that gets really big. So there's now fewer and fewer geodesics that are very high, and so fewer geodesics where the matching problem is sort of very extreme. Because it's only a very, very extreme problem when the geodesic goes very high. But there are sort of more geodesics total. And these umbrellas that you build sort of have to span the height from cutoff to target. So umbrellas get bigger. So ultimately, there's some sort of quantitative computation that these two factors that are in your favor beat out these two factors that are not in your favor. So although you have more geodesics in total where you have a matching problem, and the umbrellas get bigger, that's dwarfed by the fact that in most geodesics the matching is better, and there are extremely few geodesics where the matching problem is bad. Okay, I'll stop there. Thank you. Questions? we glue together this sort of, it's like a cascade of hamster wheels. And we just keep gluing on hamster wheels, tilting down, until we get below the target height.
But the hamster wheel points straight down, it doesn't have this nice...
No, the hamster wheel does not really point straight down, because again, if I have this pants that looks like this, so then to glue on a hamster wheel, the hamster wheel
so
has to point
shoot
up. They
down.
Shoot up, but then they shoot straight down. You bend them so they shoot up to the minimal extent, and then they go straight down and they don't make any more unnecessary high cusp excursions. Yeah?
If you didn't require closed surface subgroups, you would be allowed on these finite volume, does that make things easier?
I think it would make things a little bit easier. They'll be something related. So right now, Jeremy Kahn and Alex Kontrovich are working on the Aaron Frey's conjecture for functioning surfaces, where they'll use some of this technology, but ultimately this computation doesn't work out. This isn't sort of solely enough. So then they have to sort of try to do something extra. But ultimately they're trying to build functioning surfaces. If there are no questions, let's thank the speaker one more time.